हेलो,
गुड आफ्टरनून
हेलो
सर।
सर, गुड
वी आर वेटिंग
आफ्टरनून।
फॉर द चेयरमैन एंड द सीनियर मेंबर मिस्टर नीरज कुमार टू ज्वाइन। यस सर, आप आ गए हैं सर।
हाँ, चेयरमैन सर भी आ गए।
फॉर
गुड
ईच
आफ्टरनून।
कैंडिडेट देयर इज अ सेपरेट लिंक, सो दैट्स व्हाई। एनीवेज, वेलकम टू दिस मॉक सेशन। Would you kindly introduce yourself and tell us more about your background, your education, about your family, and about your career goals? Carry on.
So my name is Jitin Krishnan. I'm coming from Kozhikode district in Kerala. And my family include my father, mother, and my sister. And she's married off. And I did my graduation in mechanical engineering from IIT Guwahati, and I also hold a minor degree in product design. And this is my second attempt in UPSC, and this is my first interview. And my official is sociology. And my interests are traveling, trying cooking recipes, and watching Hollywood movies.
Watching?
Hollywood movies.
Hollywood movies. Okay. Tell us some of the last Hollywood movies which you have seen, and out of various movies you have seen so far, which movie has struck you most and why?
Sir, I keep on watching some movies over and over again, and one movie that I watch over and over again is Shawshank Redemption. And
the movie, say it again, the voice was cracking.
I'm sorry, the movie's name is Shawshank Redemption.
Okay.
So that is about a prison break that a person wrongly convicted wait for 25 years in order to break the prison and come out. And that is very inspirational movie for me. And it also gives me some motivation to continue my journey in UPSC also. So that's something that I keep on watching again and again.
You don't usually prefer to watch Indian movies, whether Hindi or Malayalam or any other language?
I watch all kinds of movies, sir. If I hear a good review about a movie, then I usually go and watch. And off late, a lot of the current cinema trends in Malayalam, in other regional languages, and even in Bollywood is very promising. So I watch a lot of those movies too.
I'm impressed by your educational background. In the 10th, you have a score of 10 out of 10 CGPA. You have a very good score in BTech also, 9.11. But you did your BTech in 2018. What have you been doing thereafter?
Just after 2018, I directly started my preparation in civil service examination. So this is my second attempt.
All right. What are your career goals? What do you intend to do?
Is it a question about if I get into the service as my first option?
No. That is number two. What are your career goals? That is just a means if you get into civil service. What do you wish to do in life?
Sir, as a goal, I would say is in my 60s and 70s, I want to be a really happy person, a very satisfied person. In the way that I have contributed something to the world, I have made some positive changes in the world that I can always brag about to my grandkids. And I find that it's not just money or something that brings happiness to myself. I feel good about myself when I tide over some challenges that I face through my skills. And I can bring something positive changes in the system or to the other or to people around me.
Suppose you join the civil services, we hope and pray you do. How would you use this medium of civil service to be happy and also to make a difference in the world?
Sir, if I can quote something that happened 2-3 days before, I met one of my teacher, and it was the first time I was telling that I was going for the personality test. So the first thing he said to me is that this is a job that can make the make a lot of contribution to other people. It can bring a smile to the other people. So I think Indian civil service is given a lot of discretions, and there are a lot of possibility where one can use one's initiatives in order to contribute for changes in the society.
Suppose you are posted as a district magistrate in a remote area somewhere, and the district is struck by pandemic in a very big way. Coronavirus striking very badly. What would you do?
Since it is a pandemic, it is not just a simple health crisis, but it has to be tackled in multiple ways. First of all, the health system, the primary health centers and other places have to be equipped in order to handle such catastrophes. And there need to be campaigns where people are made aware of what the disease is and how it can be prevented. And all the social distance protocols and other methods need to be employed through law and order. So it has to be a concerted effort from all police department, from the health workers, etc. And also even celebrities for campaigns, where it is a concerted effort to make changes in the district.
How can you use your background of technology to curb the pandemic, to control the pandemic? What use of this technology can take place?
So, primarily, technology can help in many ways. Since I am from a mechanical engineering background, one initiative that struck into my mind is making of cheap ventilators, which was very reliable in a very affordable manner. So that is one thing that I can think of. And other ways, improving the supply chain management of this delivery of essential goods and services. That can be optimized to increase the efficiency of tackling the pandemic, because we have seen a lot of mismanagement of the oxygen supplies. Where it was needed, it wasn't there. Where it was not much needed, there was a overstocking of supplies. So these things could have been avoided, and technology can always help in the dissemination of ideas and for campaigns, and also tracing and tracking of people, as we have seen through the Arogya Sethu app.
Let me change the question. Suppose in the district, there are a lot of floods. There is some breach which has taken place, and from a dam or somewhere, flood waters are gushing in, and it has broken a lot of infrastructure, and there is a sudden emergency, and you are posted there as district magistrate. What would you do?
So the first thing is to evacuate people as soon as possible from those places which can get badly damaged from this dam outflow, as you were mentioning. So that primary thing is to take people out to safer, higher locations, like which are in higher in elevation. And also, as an example from my state, I have seen that the district collectors here have used the help of fishermen in order to bring out people from a lot of tribal hamlets and other places. The next thing will be to provide with adequate supplies, essential supplies for the people to survive in this rescue centers. And a hope has to be given to these people. And also the people who are badly damaged because of these floods have to be given the medical attention that they deserve. So so I think we need some army support or something for helicopter support in order to take these people to safer hospitals because the roads can be badly damaged. So these are the immediate ways we can we have to confront this scenario.
Which newspapers do you read?
I read Indian Express of late.
Did you read it today?
Yes, sir.
Which is the news which struck you the most?
Sir, in a split second, I couldn't remember well, but I think there was a news of stalling of the parliament because of the protest that has been going on regarding Pegasus and the farm bill.
What do you think of this Pegasus, this issue?
The basic issue is the argument that the investigative agencies have been using this Pegasus in order to spy on certain important people. So as the manufacturer of this software, the NSO is always saying that they have not sold it to any non-governmental organization. So it is alleged that the government has used it to surveil on people. So I think any surveillance beyond the due process of law is against the right to privacy. If at all it has to happen for the national interest, it should be.
That will do. Thank you. Neeraj ji, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Jitin, yes, sir. You took sociology as your optional subject. Have yes, you sir. Heard of Verrier Elwin?
Sorry, sir?
Have you heard of Verrier Elwin?
Yes, sir. I heard of him, but in the context of Indian sociology.
Yes. So, what do you know of him?
Sir, I think his policies influenced the government policies regarding the tribal dilemma that has been happening at the time of independence. So there was a question of if the tribals had to be administered, they had to be perfectly integrated, or they had to be given the autonomy that they were enjoying till then. So Verrier Elwin, as I know, had the argument that they had to have separate kind of administration. So it was called National Park. I'm not recollecting the exact word, but that National Park approach, I think.
Which part of India did he come from?
Sorry, sir. I need to read upon that more.
Okay. Have you heard of Elgar Parishad?
No, sir, I haven't. I need to brush up those areas more.
And Bhima Koregaon, have you heard of Bhima Koregaon?
Yes, sir, I have heard of that.
Yeah, what was Bhima Koregaon? How was it in the news?
Sir, it was regarding the celebration of 200 years of the battle that has happened in 1818. So it was a sort of identity for the Dalits that was against the Marathas. Those are the dominant caste in Maharashtra. So that was perceived as a subaltern emergence or uprising, and it was suppressed later. Involving a lot of anti-national allegations also. So that is my brief understanding about Bhima Koregaon.
What was the Battle of Bhima Koregaon in 1818?
Sir, it was the third Anglo-Maratha battle in which a lot of Dalits were parts of the British army, which was fighting against the then Maratha Peshwas and Sindhias. So it happened in Bhima Karegaon in Maharashtra. So in which the British army defeated the Maratha army. So as
they defeated the Peshwas, they defeated the Peshwas.
Yes, sir.
And why was it taken as the victory of Dalits over higher castes?
Sir, because of the caste discrimination that has been happening in Maharashtra during those times in the Maratha Empire, Dalits were not taken as a part of the Maratha army. Rather, they were, however, they were recruited in the British army, who did not care too much about the caste identity. So it was a victory of Dalit power as a part of British army. So that is something that they're proud about.
Who are the social reformers in our history you are aware of, who have worked the most in removing the caste barriers in our society?
Sir, I can recall the names of Rajaram Mohan Roy, Srinarayana Guru, Ayyankali. The two above mentioned are from my home state of Kerala. And I can recollect about Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar and Jyotiba Phule from Maharashtra.
But in our modern history, somebody who was very much a part of our freedom struggle, there was somebody who also worked very hard to remove the caste differences.
Yes, sir. Ambedkar and Mahatma Gandhi also was a big force in against fighting the caste repressions.
But Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and Mahatma Gandhi did not see eye to eye over certain subjects. Are you aware what were the differences over?
Yes, sir. There were ideological differences and also about the way of implementing the reduction of wedge between different castes, because Gandhiji saw caste as something very fundamental to the Indian society and as an egalitarian concept. He believed that it was something God has created, and a difference of occupation did not mean difference of status. However, Ambedkar believed in the total annihilation of caste. He believed that it is totally oppressive and it should not have a place in the modern world. So that is the fundamental difference that they had.
Dr. B.R. Ambedkar wrote a very seminal essay on the caste system. Have you heard of it?
I'm sorry, sir. I can't recollect any particulars about that.
Okay. Rajiv ji.
Thank you, sir. Hello, Jitin.
Hello, sir.
Jitin, one of your hobbies is traveling. How do you choose a destination? I mean, what will go into the choice of a destination?
The primary thing, it depends on where I am. And the next thing is depending on my mood. So if I'm feeling very energetic and if I feel like I want to go into a very happening place, then I'll probably go to some city centers or marketplaces, etc. Or if I have a mood to enjoy the nature, or if I want to get lost into my own thoughts, I would go to some place very quiet and have some pristine untouched nature.
Please go ahead.
And it also depends on other factors. If I can have a proper conveyance to get there, and if I can get back in the right time to keep up with my schedules and also eat something that is good over there. And it also depends on what my friends also say. If they have an opinion for some place, then that also comes as a big part of consideration.
Okay. When are you completely satisfied with the at the end of the travel? What makes you, what gives you satisfaction that you after a travel?
So the primary completion of the travel itself is very satisfactory, because once we start traveling, then nothing is in our control. So challenges keeps on coming and coming. So there'll be something memorable in every travel, like a bursting of a tire where we have to get stranded somewhere, some places where we didn't have food to survive. So things keep on coming, and at the end of the day, you'll be very tired and you'll be really loving to hug the bed.
Okay. So that's so in your okay. So in your mechanical engineering, can you tell me the impediments to growth of the electrical vehicle?
The primary impediment is the availability of rare earth minerals, you know, especially lithium, in order to create batteries. And we are also struggling to find a very sustainable solution for battery production. So that is the primary challenge. And there are other challenges involved in electric vehicles, because most of our electricity dependence is right now in conventional sources, because 70% of energy is being produced from coal. So we also need renewable source of energy for that. Another thing is regarding the range of electric vehicles, because most of the electric vehicles affordable in the market, that is the Hyundai Kona, MG ZS EV, and the Tata Nexon. So none of them can boast a range of more than 200 to 250 kilometers. So that is pretty insecure to a common middle class man in India who have to buy electric car for 16 lakh and he cannot go out of a big perimeter. So those are the areas where.
Okay. Now about Kerala, have you heard of the coastal regulation zones of in Kerala?
Yes, sir.
Under the provisions of these rules, some building was, I think, it had to be struck down. They had to be demolished. What was that society named?
I think it is Marida Flat Society.
So they were in demolished. violation of which part of the CRZ?
Sir, I think it is the part of Zone C. That was being in violation because the density was less. However, there was a transformation of that place from a rural area to urban area. I'm not aware of the nitty-gritties of the technicalities involved, but...
That will do. Okay. What are the GPS coordinates of Kozhikode?
I need to look up on that, sir. Need I'm not sure. That.
Okay. Where did first the Kozhikode, I'm not talking about history, but about rather the modern history. Where did Kozhikode, how did it come into the world history map, on the map of the world history? What had happened?
Sir, I think the event that you're referring would be the 1498 travel of Vasco da Gama.
Yes.
So that was something that changed history of India and rather Asia, where Portuguese landed on the shores of Kozhikode, that is in Kapad Beach near Kozhikode.
Yes, okay. What was the non-plan expenditure, which we called the non-plan expenditure earlier, got transformed? Which was the organization of the department which is now looking after the role of the non-plan expenditure today?
I'm not
should
sure
I,
about
should
that.
Should I reframe my answer? Should I reframe my answer?
Sir, I'm sure I don't know the answer for that. So.
Okay. So, you're not aware of what the non-plan expenditure meant to the government earlier and in what shape it has come to today?
I need to read on that, sir.
Okay. Now, what is the distinction between the LAC and the LOC?
The line of control is the line delineated through Shimla Agreement in 1972, and that is between India and Pakistan. And LAC came is an agreement with LAC is a demarcation that came after our agreement with China in 1992. So,
yeah. You want to say something more?
So one is with Jammu and Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan. However, the other is between India, like Ladakh and Aksai Chin.
Okay. Now, have you heard of the term Integrated Ombudsman Scheme that was announced by the RBI? What does it seek to do?
I need to read on that, sir.
Okay. Another one is take you to the traveling part again. When you travel, what are the areas that you look into? I mean, what is it that you seek to see or to experience while deciding upon a place to visit?
Usually, I don't go too much to the most touristy places. Of course, I just have a visit over there, but I like to explore the vibe of the place, like how the people over there live and what do they eat. And there will be more very raw scenes of everyday life that we can witness over there.
Okay.
And not just people, but also the nature over there.
What form has untouchability taken in India today? Untouchability.
It has taken multiple forms because the recent Sabarimala judgment said that the women not being allowed in the temple is also a form of untouchability. But in the traditional sense, it refers to the untouchability as it was practiced between upper castes and Dalits. That is through the judgment of Mysore High Court, I guess, in the past.
What was the main point of difference between Hegel and Karl Marx?
I think Karl Marx was a materialist. However, Hegel was an idealist because ideas were the fundamental basis of human existence for him. However, Karl Marx refuted that without materials, you can't even live. That is primary need for a person or a human life.
So is caste today assuming the form and functions of a class?
Actually, in the beginning, in the time of the independence, according to the studies of André Bettel, the caste and class was almost synonymous. However, recently, sociological studies states that the class caste nexus is slowly breaking down. So I would argue against that argument that they are still synonymous to each other. Even though we can see similarities, however, that is diverging.
Okay, on sociology itself, one last question is that how has the community development programs transformed the rural and agrarian transformation? How, in what shape is it being seen today?
Sir, I think community development program that started in early 1950s were a block-based development program where most of the fundamental infrastructure that was needed for a dignified human subsistence was foundation was laid by that program. The health infrastructure, the electricity came to a lot of places. However, there were a lot of shortcomings also, which made us to think over more participative democracy or the local self-government led democracy.
Okay, thank you, sir. To unmute, sir.
Yes, I always mute otherwise to avoid echo. I won't be able to hear you properly. Thanks a lot. Nice to hear you. And I must again say, Jitin, that you are very impressive. Your overall performance seems very nice, logical, to the point. What I need to tell you is that, first of all, when you go for the interview, go properly dressed. Wear a tie if you can. Preferably a jacket also, but if you can't wear, not to worry. Sit straight, speak with confidence, collect your thoughts properly, give a structured reply. So that is the usual stuff. When you enter the room, greet the panel first, the chairman, the eye, and then turn your head around and stuff like this. But most importantly, the interview is a test of your personality. It is not a test of your knowledge, but a knowledge will give you confidence. If you don't know anything, don't worry. Just say, sorry, sir, I don't know. But if you can know, prepare as best as you can. Prepare a list of possible questions which can arise out of your background about your interests. You have given interest, which is very sort of interesting and slightly unusual, watching Hollywood movies, cooking recipes. When these are all very interesting areas, people can ask you about recipes, people can ask you about Hollywood movies, traveling, where do you wish usually like to travel and what have you seen and stuff like this. So anticipate possible questions, prepare yourself. Also on contemporary issues. Now your background and contemporary issues together, if they can be combined into possible questions, it would be useful for you to prepare 20, 30, 40 possible questions, some of them very well, which possibly you can divert, you can swing the discussions towards those areas. So have you taken any mock interviews so far?
Yes, sir. I have taken a couple of mock interviews.
When is your actual interview likely to be held?
It's on September 2nd. So I have
plenty
a month
of, plenty of time. Maybe you would like to take a couple of more. Depends on you. Even if you don't, do some practice before a mirror or record or something. In the past mock interviews, have you been given any tips as to what you should be doing?
I often hear something about my voice modulation. So the panel members usually comment that I have a flat tone, very monotonous. So it will be very good to make it more lively. So that is something that I'm working upon now.
Good. So I don't know how much you can modulate during the remaining weeks, but certainly if you can try, it will be useful. In the sense that bring some more life into it, but let it should not look artificial. You should be absolutely normal. I don't find anything wrong with you. But if you can have a slight smile on your face, sit straight. And in the voice, idea is that there should be some emotion. Your voice should be reflective of your thoughts. It is, you know, merged with your thoughts. When you wish to convey something, the tone and tenor of your voice is generally in accordance with the thoughts, the expressions, and so on. So that's the idea. But you have a tremendous presence in terms of your personality. Your background is impressive. With a little bit of effort, I'm sure you can make it. So I wish you all the best. Neeraj-ji, would you like to say something?
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Jitin, since your optional subject was sociology, I asked you certain questions connected with that. For instance, I asked you about Verrier Elwin. You knew a bit about him, but you didn't know that he was a Britisher. He came as a missionary. And then he quit his missionary order to work full time with the tribals. You knew about his differences with the then government and his idea of isolating the tribals, etc. But your knowledge was a bit superficial. You should have known a little more about him. Similarly,
I knew about it. Even he married a tribal woman from Central India. But I was not so confident to answer it before I pressured that sociology part again.
I asked you which part of India he came from, and you said, yeah, you didn't know. He came, he didn't belong to India, he belonged to Britain. He studied at Oxford and he came here as a missionary. Then he resigned from his missionary order to work full time. And anyone who has studied sociology or anthropology has to know about Verrier Elvin in great detail. He worked with Gonds, he worked with the tribes of the Northeast, and he has written several books. So you should know a little more. Similarly, for the same reason I asked you about Bhima Koregaon and Elgar Parishad, then the differences of opinion between Mahatma Gandhi and B.R. Ambedkar, and how there was a Pune Pact to bring them together and so on. So the essay written by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar is The Annihilation of Caste, which you must read. It is available on the net. So any student of sociology must read that essay. Otherwise, your knowledge base was fine. As the chairman sir has said, don't worry too much about voice modulation. We all have our natural way of speaking. It's only people who work for the theater or who have to indulge in oratory often who have to learn how to modulate their voice. There's nothing seriously wrong with your voice modulation. Okay?
So usually I'm a very cerebral person. So I think that lack of emotion is getting reflected in my speech also. I'm not sure.
What do you mean by saying you are a cerebral person?
Like I tend to look at the more rational things in a more rational way than an emotional way. So,
in future, don't ever say that I'm a cerebral person. That will sound as if you're trying to boast of. Cerebral means someone who's very intelligent. Okay?
Okay, okay.
So that's the common connotation. So, No. Don't get into these details.
Okay.
Focus on your preparation. Focus on preparing, things like the Indian Constitution, Mahatma Gandhi, current affairs, international affairs, things like that. Don't worry about these silly things, okay? Rajiv ji, over to you.
Yes, sir. Jitin, very small observations I would make after what has been said by the chairman and Neeraj sir. One is that your answer, especially I brought back the topic of travel again, it was a bit longish. So you need to, you need to put it in special perspective as to what exactly, and especially on the observation that you made that I go there according to the mood. I thought that after you go there, your mood is supposed to change. But you said that in a particular mood, I go to a particular place. But anyway, that's a way of... But too many answers were, preceded by, I think. I don't think it's a proper way of replying. We know that only your thoughts are coming into the... Now, listen, on one question that I put to you about the planning commission, about the non-plan expenditure, the form it has taken today. That you'll have to do some reading on that. But what is, I'll just give you very briefly in about 30, 40 seconds. See, the Rangarajan Committee in 2011 recommended that this system be abolished and that it should take a new form. And so thereafter, in fact, the basis for the non-plan expenditure and plan expenditure, their division was discussion the government used to have with the Planning Commission. Now, with the Planning Commission dismantled in 2016, a new form was taken in which the spending of the government is now seen in a new perspective from 2017-18. That is the revenue and the capital spending. It, in fact, synergizes the experience, the divisions of these into earning, spending, and outcomes. This is the format in which the non-plan, earlier non-plan expenditure has now taken the shape and form of the government. Niti Aayog. Niti Aayog is the one which monitors it, which pilots it, and in the form of synergies in the earning, spending, and outcomes outcomes of the government expenditure. So just read about it. It's otherwise you knew quite a bit of everything. Keep your answer little shorter, especially on areas like traveling and all. You can just put 2-3 points, but unless you are asked to elaborate, don't make it too longish. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Rajiv. So I wish you, on behalf of the panel, our best wishes. We hope and pray that you succeed, and we see your name in the list of successful candidates. So all the best, Jitin.
All the best, Jitin. Do well. Do very well.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Have a good day.
Bye.
Thank you.